Good morning. Welcome. We're glad you're here. This morning may look a little different than what we're used to. Our 6th to 12th graders are leading us in worship this morning, and we are excited to do so. I want to draw your attention to some announcements before we begin. Graduate Recognition Sunday is going to be June 11th. If you have a high school or college or vocational school, tech school graduate, student, or you're one yourself, please let us know. We'd love to recognize you on that morning. If you're a high school graduate, we will process through on the 11:10 service. But please let us know of that. Next week is Pentecost, May 28th. Please wear red that morning. We will, during the Sunday school hour, have a celebration together. So there will be no traditional Sunday school, but we will be together. We'll take a church picture and celebrate with some cupcakes for celebration of Pentecost, and have that time of fellowship together during that hour. Vacation Bible school signups are full, maybe almost full, really close to being full. So if you have not signed up yet and you would like your child to be in VBS, please do so soon. I believe signups are closing on Friday, so that's coming up quick. All the summer things coming up quick. And our summer Sunday school is starting June 4th. So our 4th through 5th graders are going to all meet in the purple room during the Sunday school hour starting on June 4th. I believe that is it for announcements. So if you can all get up and greet one another, say good morning to someone. You can all find your seats and be seated. We will come together for our call to worship.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. Give thanks to the God of gods. Give thanks to the Lord of lords.
Would you please stand and join us in our opening hymn?
Scripture of adoration and invocation is taken from 1 Chronicles chapter 29, verses 10 through 13. Blessed are you, O Lord, the God of Israel, our Father, forever and ever. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty, for all that is in the heavens and in the earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord, and you are exalted as head above all. Both riches and honor come from you, and you rule over all. In your hand are power and might, and in your hand it is to make great and to give strength to all. And now we thank you, our God, and praise your glorious name.
His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord. He is the mighty King, Master of everything. His name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord. He's the great shepherd, the rock of all ages. Almighty God is He. Bow down before Him, love and adore Him. His name is wonderful, Jesus, my Lord.
You may be seated. Our call to confession is from James chapter 5, verse 16. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person has great power as it is working.
Please join me in the unison prayer of confession. I acknowledge my sin to you, and I did not cover my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and forgive the iniquity of my sin. Therefore, let everyone who is godly offer prayer to you at a time when you may be found.
Surely, in the rush of great waters, they shall not reach him. You are a hiding place for me. You preserve me from trouble. You surround me with shouts of deliverance.
The assurance of pardon comes from Isaiah 5, 6, and 7. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, that he may have compassion on him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel.
In Jesus Christ we are forgiven. Alleluia.
You may be seated. Please bow your heads with me as we prepare our offering. We come before you, Lord, in worship to you, and as we prepare our offering, we ask that you prepare our hearts to give back to you and what you have given to us. All we have is from you, and we offer a portion of it back. We ask that you take this offering to use your kingdom, and that your glory may be a pinnacle of all that is done. In your name, amen.
The beginning beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus.
Seen a cloud and forever over me, but I believe your rain is coming. Yeah, I've been hanging on the high hopes, 'cause you're the one who's making dry bones come to life. You're the light I put my trust in. Every word you say is gonna come true. You will lead me to the promised land. Everything you say is gonna happen, even though I haven't seen it yet. I will build a boat in the sand where they say it never rains. I will stand up in faith. I'll do anything it takes with you in my sails. Your love never fails or fades. I'll build a boat in the desert place, and when the flood and the water starts to rise, yeah, I'll ride the storm, 'cause I got you by my side. With you in my sails, your love never fails. You will lead me to the promised land. Everything you say is gonna happen.
Scripture today comes from Acts. I kid. Our scripture today is 1 Kings 12, 1 through 15. It is in your pew Bibles. All throughout the Bible, we see people who struggle with their identity and overcome influences. And in today's life, we have the same struggle, especially with the rise of social media. Influencing has not only become a problem, it is now a career. And people are being influenced all the time to do things they shouldn't, just like in the Bible. So 1 Kings 12, 1 through 15. Rehoboam went to Shechem, for all Israel had gone there to make him king. When Jeroboam, son of Nebat, heard this, he returned from Egypt. So they sent for Jeroboam, and he and the whole assembly of Israel went to Rehoboam and said to him, "Your father put a heavy yoke on us. But now lighten the harsh labor and the heavy yoke he put on us, and we will serve you." Rehoboam answered, "Go away for 3 days, and then come back to me." So the people went away. The king Rehoboam consulted the elders who had served his father Solomon during his lifetime. "How would you advise me to answer the people?" he asked. They replied, "If today you will be a servant to these people and serve them and give them a favorable answer, they will always be your servants." But Rehoboam rejected the advice the elders gave him and consulted the young men who had grown up with him and were serving him. He asked them, "What is your advice? How should we answer the people who say to me, 'Lighten the yoke your father put on us'?" The young men who had grown up with him replied, "These people have said to you, 'Your father put a heavy yoke on us, but make our yoke lighter. Now tell them, my little finger is thicker than my father's waist. My father laid on you a heavy yoke. I will make it even heavier. My father scourged you with whips. I will scourge you with scorpions. 3 days later, Jeroboam and all the people returned to Rehoboam. As the king said, come back to me in 3 days. The king answered the people harshly, rejecting the advice given to him by the elders. He followed the advice of the young men and said, my father made your yoke heavy. I will make it even heavier. My father scourged you with whips. I will scourge you with scorpions. So the king did not listen to the people, for this turn of events was from the Lord, to fulfill the word of the Lord had spoken to Jeroboam. This is the word of the Lord. Later, this passage goes on to talk about how the 10 tribes of Israel then proceeded to split and become independent from the king. So clearly, his friends did not give him the best advice. And we can relate to this because we are constantly being influenced to do things that we know are wrong and are told are wrong, and yet we do them anyways. Especially with the rise of social media, it is literally people's jobs to influence us to do things. We know of the new upcoming career of TikTok influencers and Instagram models. They literally make money off of getting us to view their content, and they're willing to do anything to get us to view their content. And this makes a new rise in trends that come and go very quickly. And some of these trends are very harmless, but others are more hurtful. And some are just silly, like the 100 Layers Challenge, where people will put on 100 shirts, or 100 layers of makeup, or 100 layers of nail polish on just one finger. Or they'll do different dances that are just silly, like, and that's the whole dance. But there are many more trends that we are being influenced to do that are far more dangerous. Like, so dangerous that you look back and think, why would anyone ever do this? Shall we bring up the Tide Pod Challenge? If you do not know what the Tide Pod Challenge is, it is because you are either not in the age group to have experienced it, or because you have enough common sense that this did not make its way to you. But basically, it was a trend where these kids were being influenced to eat Tide Pods. And if you don't know what a Tide Pod is, that is laundry detergent. And then there was the Kiki Do You Love Me Challenge, where people would put their cruise control to like 3 miles an hour, 2 miles an hour, and they'd set up their camera in their car, and then they would get out of their car while it's still moving and do a dance alongside their moving car, going, Kiki, do you love me? Alongside their moving car. And there are many, many videos of people hitting things with their car. I mean, what do you expect? You're getting out of the driver's seat. And then there's many videos of people getting hit by their own car. I don't know how that's possible, but. And then there's the more recent Devious Licks Challenge, where people are going around their school trying to steal the best thing. And it started with paper towel dispensers and clocks from off of the walls. And then it slowly got worse. People were stealing bathroom stall doors, toilets, sinks, and now it's moved out into society where people are stealing traffic signs, traffic lights. I didn't know that was possible, but that is a devious lick. And the worst part is not only are they influencing us to do these things as we see them do it, but we are influencing them to do it too, because those are the videos with the most likes. And even worse than just those being physically dangerous, there are also so many more videos that are morally dangerous. People breaking laws on camera, people talking about sexual immorality, people being sexually immoral on camera. And it has become so normalized in society that even children are partaking in it. There are 10-year-olds and 12-year-olds who have access to these videos, and their parents do not know. We need to know what we should be doing versus what we are doing and what we are being encouraged to do by these videos. These videos can quickly turn from innocent to very toxic behavior. and we need to know what we should be doing. And luckily, we have the Bible to tell us exactly what we should and should not be doing. And these trends are not what we should be doing. Just like Rehoboam, even our friends can lead to our downfall. Our friends have so much influence on who we are and what we do that we have to be very careful on who we choose to let into our life. I always go back to the quote, "If your friends would jump off a bridge, would you too?" Yes, I know I would. I would be the second person jumping off that bridge. But it just goes to show, we do what our friends do. Our friends do what we do. We are a very tight-knit group when you have good friends. So you need to be very careful on what you're letting your friends influence you to do. However, with social media, it's not only difficult to know who you are letting into your life, it's almost impossible. You see videos from people you've never seen in your life, you'll never know, and it's all based off of what the algorithm recommends to you. These are chosen based off of things you've previously liked, and even things that your friends have liked or other people that you follow. When trying to think about what I wanted my sermon to be, I knew I wanted it to be something about labels or identity. And I was talking to my mom about it, and it reminded me of this one documentary I saw on Netflix called The Social Dilemma. And the entire documentary is about how these people who used to work for these big name companies like Facebook and Google have since left and have dedicated their whole life to warning people about how dangerous these companies are. They have so much influence on what you're thinking and the things that you see, and we take them for granted. And it's entirely based off of your interests. So let's take an example. Let's say you see a picture of a cow, and you want to like the picture of a cow because it's a funny looking cow. And then the next time you go on Instagram or Facebook, you see another picture of a cow, and you think to yourself, well, I liked one picture of a cow. I might as well like another picture of a cow. And that slowly leads to more pictures of cows. So you just follow the account, because why not? And then that account happens to be owned by a farmer of cows who's also a climate change activist. And then slowly you start to see that your feed has become more towards climate change activism because someone you follow is a climate change activist. And this is totally fine until you look at someone else's feed. Let's say instead of liking a picture of a cow, they like a picture of an inspirational quote from a president. Let's say Eisenhower. And you can definitely see how this would lead to an entirely different set of news streams. Instead of getting information about how we need to protect the environment and save the environment, they might be getting information about it's a hoax. And they believe it 100%, both people. How are we supposed to agree on anything when we are constantly getting different sets of news? No wonder society is more divided than ever when we can't agree on anything because we are being constantly influenced to believe different things all the time. If you ever think to yourself, why can't they just see it how I see it? Why don't they know the truth if I know the truth? They're thinking the exact same thing, but about the exact opposite side. In this day and age, it is very important that we are looking for the truth, and it is incredibly hard to find. Just like how Rehoboam let his friends influence him, we very often let our friends and anyone influence us. We have to make sure that the people that we let influence us are the ones that God would want us to be influenced by. Just like it says in 1 Corinthians 15:33, "Do not be misled. Bad company corrupts good morals." Who we let have an influence on us has a huge effect on who you are as a person. So we should surround ourselves with good morals, good character, surround ourselves with Christians. This is why it's very important that we come to church and we have a community of believers who know the truth. We know that the truth is that God loves us and Jesus died on the cross for our sins, and there is nothing else that matters. Because we are Christians and we do know the truth, it is very important that we do not get influenced by others, but we go out there and we are influencers. Do not let the world decide what is right. With social media, it is so easy to go out there and spread Christianity, and yet we still decide to let the world and evil win. Do not let the For You page change who you are. Do not let your Instagram or Facebook feed decide who you do and don't talk to anymore. Because while all this is going on in the world, we know the truth. We can go out there and spread the truth. Jesus died on the cross for our sins and was raised 3 days later. What is going on in the world right now is not going to matter in heaven. What trend is popular right now is not going to matter in a month, in a year, or ever again. And we, as one body of Christians, know this.
Would you please stand and join us in our final hymn found in your bulletin?
Please stand.